on big. We go for a Guinness World Record while we build the world's largest toaster. It is on.
This is all this dust. I like oil and grease, not dust.
Who's gonna make us a bagel that big? I'm asking you. When you go big, there's always danger.
We did. No, that's what you call toast. Yeah!
The humble toaster. It's a fixture in most American households and an icon of 20th century design. But toast has been a favorite around the world since long before the electric toaster emerged in 1909.
In fact, since ancient Rome, the search has been underway to make the perfect piece of toast. Each century has made its own attempt at creating a golden brown goodness. The electric toaster is the end of a search lasting over 2,000 years. What took so long? They were thinking too small. That's why we're giving the big treatment to the humble toaster. There's no current Guinness World Record for the largest toaster, and I want to set one that's unbeatable. So my toaster is going to be at least 10 feet wide and 7 feet high. And it's going to work just like a regular toaster. Pushing down a lever will complete an electric circuit, which will heat up metal wires and activate an electromagnet to hold the toast down. A timer will trigger the release of the magnet, causing the heat to turn off and the toast to pop. Finally, finding a piece of bread as big as a kitchen table will have his own set of challenges. I'm giving my team 5 days to set a Guinness World Record. If they make it, it'll be their name in a record book. If not, no glory, and more importantly, no toast. Let the challenge begin.
So the first step is to make our heating element. This is one of the heating element panels. This wire, it's probably a nichrome wire. This is one of the few projects where we're actually gonna have to do some testing to see what works for us.
The team sets out on its quest for the world record by testing the heating element wires.
We're measuring a specific length of wire to make sure that the voltage is going to heat it up to the proper temperature. Explain that to him, Gadget.
The resistance in the wire varies over its length. So the longer the piece of wire is, the lower the temperature, because there's more resistance in the wire.
Hopefully nobody goes over and touches it, thinks it's pretty.
Stand back, we're gonna test this now and see if we have enough
back,
length.
Back. Oh, look at it!
Boom! Yeah.
Oh, see, pink, it's pink. Woo-hoo. Yeah, baby, that's what I wanted to see.
That's what I'm talking about.
That is what I wanted to see.
Judging by the orange color that we had of our wire, it's probably pretty close to 1,000 degrees.
Having determined the right length for the elements, the team can now attach them to the panels to fit inside the toaster.
We're gonna lay out this board to where we're gonna put the wires in to make the heating element.
It's called millboard. It's made out of clay and mica and silica. They use it for building kilns and in foundries. It'll take up to 1,000 degrees heat.
This takes 1,000 degrees?
Yeah.
Man, that's amazing.
Gadget!
Can you tell us what kind of wire that you have?
This is nichrome wire.
Nichrome wire.
It's nickel chromium. It heats up a lot when you apply current to it. The nice thing about it is that you can heat it repeatedly. It lasts better than most other types of heating wire. Testing!
Wow, there it goes. They're short.
Are they?
They moved right, those two moved right together.
Yeah, we're gonna have to put, we need something else to manage the wire. What's happening now is when we plug it in,
expands.
The wire is expanding so much, it's touching and shorting, and then it gets even hotter. The temperature that the wire warms up to is dependent on its length. So if you start shorting it, it gets hotter. So if we get too many shorts, it's gonna get white hot and just melt.
Couple bridges, that's all.
We're gonna put each wire in one of these slots to keep them from moving, because they keep wanting to run together.
Testing.
Fire in the hole.
Oh.
With the first task down, it looks like this team may have what it takes to set the Guinness World Record.
It takes five. That's five builders.
That Lisa LeJean is a hell of a welder.
Well, where are you waiting, Eric? Have fun.
Kurt Schaefer, everybody. Kurt Schaefer.
I'm glad these guys let me hang out with them, because it's fun. I like to be here.
Thad's a new builder here helping.
Dad's working out great.
Seems like he's been around the machines.
Yeah. I was hoping to meet these guys, and I'll get them to sign my ass. You want to give me a kiss?
Eric is a classic Eric. He's, he's...
Anybody want some toast?
Eric, that's exactly what he is, a crazy.
What am I?
My best buddy, bud.
What were we talking about?
What am I saying here?
Oh, right, so.
Because we all realize that it is Gadget World and he just lets us live here.
Yeah.
Gadget, we chose to be the engineer.
Radiant energy does fall off by the square of its distance.
12 times 12 times 12, 1,728.
That's one of the simplest equations in physics. I am the engineer.
When I met Gadget, I put a lot past him. Now I don't. This guy's got a life that you wouldn't even be able to begin to understand.
When we're fabricating the ends, these are made out of plastic. We don't have the facility to make giant plastic ends, so easiest way for us to do it is to make it out of wood and paint it.
Since plywood panels don't come big enough for this project, Kurt begins by creating a king-size sheet of wood.
Standard size is 4x8. Our actual dimensions are going to be 5x6'8".
Kurt uses round discs, called biscuits, to seam the two plywood panels together, making 1 5-foot sheet. But Kurt, is putting wood close to the heating elements such a hot idea?
We can coat the backsides with some fire retardant and there should be no problem. And I'm not getting inside it, so it's okay. And that's the base plate for our sides.
While the build gets off to a smooth start, Frank has already discovered a problem. Where will he get bread big enough for his big toaster?
Yeah, give me a bit. Come here, turn that off for a second.
Sorry, good.
What's the matter?
Thanks, man.
The problem is with the toaster. It's too big. I mean, how big is this toaster gonna be? The toasting section of it.
5x5, so if you make a bread, maybe 4 feet.
4 feet by 5 feet?
Yeah, it's a big loaf.
You know, I've been measuring all my bread over there, and I can't get a loaf, you know, a slice bigger than 6 inches.
Yeah.
6 inches isn't big enough.
No, not for this toaster.
Well, can you make me a bread pan?
Yeah.
If you can make me a bread pan, I'll see if I can get someone to cook with it.
Okay.
Okay.
And we'll leave it to the baker to figure out how to make it that big.
Thanks, guys.
No problem.
Tell us what you make of it. So while Gadget figures out how to make us a big slice of bread, I'm gonna look for some toppings to put on it. You have jams, you have preserves, and you have jellies. What's the difference?
Well, the jellies, we use just the juice from the berries. The way we make jam is we take the seeds out of the berries.
Okay.
So it's more of a smoother texture than preserves. Right. The preserves is the whole fruit.
Oh, how do you make it?
Well, we make it like you make it at home.
Just like I make it at home, huh?
So, you mix 1,200 pounds of corn syrup in a 300-gallon kettle with 1,200 pounds of strawberries, and you let it simmer. Then a vacuum pump sucks up the mixture into a kettle that holds 2,500 pounds, where it's vacuum cooled at 175 degrees for 45 minutes until it cooks down to 1,900 pounds. The final mixture is pumped into a holding tank from where it's poured automatically into a sanitized jar 10 at a time. These jars are vacuum sealed and cooled down from 195 degrees to 85 degrees. Finally, the jars are fed by conveyor past the labeling machine, sorted, counted, and boxed. Yeah, just like at home. Love that sound.
So this is just like I make it at home, huh?
Just like you make it at home.
This is good stuff.
Back at the shop, Thad is taking the lead on the toaster's frame.
We've got two frames going on today, an inner frame and an outer frame.
The inner frame will be the main body of the toaster, holding the heating elements, the toaster carriers, and the popping mechanism. The outer frame will fit over it, forming the familiar shape of a household toaster.
This is gonna be the structure for the heating element boards.
Oh, I like it. Muy bien.
We like a little more heat.
But with Lisa and Thad firmly in control of the metalwork, Eric has little to do but watch.
We'll blow these things out in no time. This is where all the heating element panels are going to bolt to this. Just grind these welds smooth and you're good to go.
Ready?
Yep. Lisa's on it.
Are you having fun yet, Dad?
All kinds.
But three metal specialists seems to be one too many for this build, and Eric's having a hard time staying busy.
I'm a builder, and I can do things, and I can be charismatic, but when I can't do my thing, it bums you out.
Well, I could have welded, but Lisa would have had a fit.
I know.
After cutting all that, you just can't even let nobody weld. That's the only thing that bothers me.
I know.
You want to show more of what you can do, and you're here to build. And at times, there's other specialists that do close to the same. So when we're doing woodwork, and there's a little welding involved, do I take that little welding and say, hey, Lisa, here's some welding? Of course. But it bums me out.
Well, you know what it says when it comes up on me? I'm a master metal fabricator. I'm a metal builder. So how come I can't weld here?
You and me both.
Rye toast with butter up.
When Big comes back, will the team be able to learn new tricks and set the world record? Or will they just get caught loafing?
Okay, I want it twice as big.
Day two begins with Master Carpenter Kurt routing a template.
Now that's a tool, baby.
He will use this template to cut ribs, which will give the toaster its rounded ends. Later, he'll skin the sides with flexible wood sheeting.
We've cut all these pieces with this here jig that I took the time to smooth out and make the radius all nice and perfect, because the key to it all is repeatability. Those are pocket holes. Those are so I don't have to line everything up from the bottom, and I can screw all that from the top. Makes life a little simpler. So if you got a pre-drill anyway, you might as well make it easy, right? Easy's good. Easy is good. Good.
Though Kurt's moving right along, Eric's still stuck without enough metal work to do. So he decides to take a toast break.
Rye toast with butter up. Rye toast, butter up!
At times, it's boring because you have nothing to do. When you're not the boss.
Okay, what do we gotta do now, Gadget?
I see Eric wandering around. If he's looking for something to do, I could use his help.
So, with little metal and lots of woodwork to do, Eric bites the bullet and apprentices himself to Kurt.
That's how you do that.
Some of these builds, you just gotta be team player. On this, I'm pretty interested in how woodworking's done. I had a woodworking teacher that recently died.
Mr. Bidleymeyer taught all the students, but kind of focused on me since I was a little hyper and mouthy, so. I wanted him to see the show and see kind of what I was doing on the show. Found out that he died of a stroke, like a sudden stroke or something. So it kind of bummed me out. So I thought about it, but since we already had Lisa doing metal work and we had Thad that does metal work, and I do metal every day, I went, you know, I'll get back in a little bit of the woodwork, and that's where I wanted to learn some of the skills that Kurt has.
Do not try that at home.
I got an A on my projects. You know, I got a D in history and math and all, but man, I got an A in shop class.
Nailing the wood.
Everybody has to be flexible. You know, we get a lot of people who are specialists, but once they get here, they can no longer be a specialist, which is what makes the builds kind of fun, because, you know, all of a sudden there you are. You know, you're good at something, but you're forced to be good at something else that maybe you've never done before.
Why don't you throw that up there and let's show them how easily this stuff wraps right over the radius. This is 1/8 inch bending poplar, so you can make circles out of it. It will bend around anything one way.
I learned some more skills and trades that will carry me on. Some of the things he's doing require learning. It's new. Some of the wood, the poplar he was using, and some of the flex board, the bending board, that's all new. You know, we didn't have a chance to use that in school. He's a good teacher, and he knows a lot of woodworking.
This is contact
dry.
So you have to apply it to that surface, then this surface. Then after it's dry, you lay it down there and you have a permanent bond. The only thing about this is you only get one shot at it. You gotta stick it in the right place. So here we go. Let's glue.
The contact cement is on and ready for careful application of the finishing layer of poplar.
First layer was just one covering up all the supports or the joisting on the inside of it, and this one here is actually going to give its beauty layer.
Go ahead and lay yours down.
There's no nail holes in it. The first one's nailed down. This one's glued in.
That is.
While Eric learns new skills from Kurt, Gadget works on installing the heating elements on the inner frame. But without nearly enough welding to do on this project, it's Lisa's turn to loaf around.
Hey, my name is Mr. Toast.
Are you serious? Gadget! How are you doing today? And what are you doing? Come on, don't hold back. Come on, Gadget, talk to me. What is it? Gadget, talk to me.
Oh, I thought I was hallucinating and Brett was talking to me.
Oh, okay.
Hey, Lisa. Can you give me a hand?
Fortunately, Thad recruits Lisa as a fabricating apprentice to help him shield the inner frame with sheet metal.
You get those little bends in these if you don't handle it right. We can't have that.
It's something I've never done, sheeting a metal. So Thad is teaching me that.
We're gonna put it in this bender over here.
Okay. So just trying to find my niche and try to contribute as much as possible.
So I got marks on here, see my marks? Go ahead, slide it in there, and we'll clamp it down on that mark. Slide it into that mark.
And there.
We'll bend our 90. Nothing to it. Material-wise, we're using a 20-gauge galvanized steel to encompass the inside heating unit. We'll take that next one, and we'll clamp it up next to this one.
Okay.
So none of the heat heats up the external sheet metal. So we'll fasten it here.
Thanks.
Slide it over and pop rivet it together.
Hey, where'd you put the rivet gun?
You go, girl.
With the inner frame sheeting done,
all good.
Thad and his new partner, Lisa, can move on to the outer frame.
Middle of day two. And we pretty much got the frame almost wrapped up. So I think between the five of us that we're making pretty good headway. This build crew is obviously the elite. And I'm here to assist them in what I can do, give them my abilities.
That's great. We're already speaking the same language. You just go over and you do.
Seems to me, I haven't worked with him that much, but he seems like he's getting along with everybody. Everything is getting done.
The best part is I can eat him afterwards.
Thad, he likes to play practical jokes. Oh, well, I was welding, and Thad was playing a joke on me at the time. I didn't realize it. Did I run out of gas here?
What's that? Looks like you got gas. Still acting up?
No, I'm trying one more time. Yeah. Yeah, it's spurting like it's losing gas. Finally, I found out he was pinching my line. You messing with my line?
Oh, you kidding?
I know, I ain't crazy.
Lisa's been good about the jokes I pulled on her. She knows. She knows I'm just kidding.
I don't know nothing about nothing, but I know my machines.
Maybe if I do any more, she might not be so much. She might slap me around a little.
As the team bonds over the build, Frank bounces to the bakery to get his big piece of bread.
Hey, Jose! What's up, brother?
Hey, how are you?
How you doing?
I'm fine, did you?
Oh, great. You should see the toaster coming along. It's looking good.
Yeah. But I got a problem.
Uh-oh.
This is the biggest I made. I'm so proud, but this is a half.
We're looking at less than 4 feet. And less than 3.
Okay, I want it twice as big.
Yes, I can do that.
Okay, so instead of 130 pounds of flour,
we're going to 190 or 200 pounds.
200 pounds. Let's do 200 pounds of flour. Jose, you're the man.
I am.
Will Frank be able to get a big enough piece of bread to prove the toaster works? The Guinness World Record depends on it.
Toast made me the man I am today.
Coming up.
We mess up one of these, I'm a dent in our toaster.
Will the team be able to pull the build and the bread together in time to set a world record.
Toast.
It's the beginning of day three. So far, the team has finished one wooden side and the inner and outer frames. Still up is the popping mechanism and the electrical.
Yep.
But today, they start by plating the sides with thin and delicate sheet metal.
This is stainless steel sheet. It's polished. This is for the side of the toaster. This is the bad side.
Look at the shine on that compared to the shine on that.
There's a real art to handling sheet metal without messing it up. We want to move the material as little as possible so that we minimize our possibility of scratching it. So we were talking about where we're going to set the break so that we can bring the sheets in from behind, minimize our movement. Because the easiest way to handle these would be to get this equipment back, try to put them in nice and neat.
What, darling?
I mean, just getting this much sheet metal on the outside with putting any dents in, it's going to be a miracle. We mess up one of these, I'm going to dent in our toaster.
I got this Candyman song in my head for some reason.
You know, it's a good thing you said that, because the one that was in my head just disappeared and I was getting tired of it.
Oh, but she's a mile short anyways.
But the test piece is short. So while Gadget reflects on how not to waste any more of the shiny sheet metal, Lisa enjoys its more hypnotic properties.
Oh, no, make me skinny.
Sorry about that.
My nipples.
I had her on top of the toilet.
But there's still plenty to do. So Gadget and Thad get back to work on skinning the outer frame. And with a little more work from these sheet metal specialists, the high sheen toaster slowly comes into focus.
Looking kind of keen.
That's perfect. For a guy who eats gummy worms out his ears, you are talented.
You know what's amazing is the impact toast has had on history. For instance, the act of standing up with a glass and making a toast actually came from toast. So what people would do, they'd take their toast and dip it in their mulled wine. Thus, the first toast was created. And right now, we're gonna go visit a bunch of people who do it best. It's a group of guys who call themselves the Toastmasters.
Tonight, I am here to toast toast. In my job, it's just like a piece of toast.
Toast is very personal to me. I take it very personally.
I love toast.
I actually owe my life to toast.
All I can say is I must give a toast to toast.
Next speaker is Frank from Big.
What can be said about my friend Toast? Waking you up in the morning, always there. Golden brown with a smile, nourishing you, giving you a start on your day, a start that nobody else can give you. It carries things for us. You can carry your lunch, a bed of lettuce, some mayonnaise. I know you like the mayonnaise. Toast carried all my meals. Toast made me the man I am today. And there's a reason toast is shaped like a blanket, because it's warm, and it keeps you warm from the inside out. And it says, let me give you nourishment. Let me start your day because nobody else can. Toast is your friend. Toast is all of our friends. I have to say one thing. Toast, wherever you are, you'll be there for me in the morning. And I'll be there for you.
Today is day 37, October 94. I think we're actually doing pretty good compared to most builds. We've got a world record. So long as we can get it together, get it to work properly, then guess what? Oh, Stuart will be out here and he'll be hooking us up again and be like, nice little plaque.
I think that we're all right. I don't think we're quite as good as everybody thinks we are. Everybody thinks we're kind of out in front of it, but I'm pretty confident that there's gonna be
a late night or two. Big stuff takes big time.
Eric is good to work with. He's a straight up guy. Anything that I've asked him to do, you know, it's, most of the techniques are not that much different than what he's used to. You know, you make your lines straight and square, and he catches right on and do whatever we need done.
We actually countersunk the screws to hold the wood together into the ends of the actual toaster. And when you actually countersink it, you have a hole this big. The special bit we have here cuts around and actually cuts out these plugs. A little glue right on the end like that. Tap it in, but leave it. And when it's done, you'll get to it and you'll sand it. And as you can see, the plugs are gone. You can barely see them up in here.
You're good. What are you going to do all this stuff,
man? Actually, this guy named Kurt Schaefer from Shapco. The only problem we've got or a challenge to deal with isn't my problem. It's all Frankie boys. That's Big Frank. You go find me a big piece of toast.
I'm on my way to pick up our second attempt at baking big bread. The Guinness World Record depends on our toaster toasting toast. If we don't do it, no world record. So hope this time it works.
Now, where's my bread?
I had a problem with your bread.
You had a little problem with my bread?
Yes, because now we use 200 pounds of dough, and it's too much for the
What happened with the dough?
The bread molder started to open on both sides.
200 pounds of dough was clearly too much for this bread pan. With two strikes against it, Frank's big bread is turning into a big problem.
Bending, bending, bending.
When Big comes back,
bow!
The team launches forward toward the Guinness World Record. As the team fortifies themselves for their fourth day of building.
Frank!
Where's the jam, sir?
Hey, guys, relax. Here you go.
Frank's in a bit of a jam.
But I do have some bad news. I stopped by the bread company that was making our flour here. Let me just bring this in.
So the difference between jam and preserved, Frank, what? They don't put the strawberries in?
They put 250 pounds of bread in here, of dough, cheese, and it would have let the rise, it broke open.
The power of bread.
Oh, man.
The power of bread.
The power of bread.
I don't know what to do.
What?
They stood it up, and that's what happened. Or they didn't stand it up, they laid it down.
No, I think it won't rise high enough.
I mean, that's a problem, Frank.
You gotta have bread to come out of the toaster. I mean, that's...
It was like, oh, this is gonna be great, it's fun, it's gonna be big, but I never thought about the bread. That it would be a problem finding a slice of bread that big.
Still, I think it's gonna have to go flat. We might have to find somebody who's got an oven that can make it flat.
Yeah.
And then go with the yeast still? Because it's pushing the thing out instead of up.
So we decided to modify the bread pan and make it so we could lay it down, and that way the yeast wouldn't have to push it up any more than about 6 inches. So in order to get this to work, Frank's gonna have to find us a wider oven.
I mean, I've eaten a lot of big pizzas in my life, but no pizza that big.
Okay, let's
get back to work.
Cool,
let's go. Good deal.
Next thing we'll need to do is to make the mechanism that actually pops the toast.
What is this?
This is the toast mechanism lifter schmigeggy thing.
The lever pulls the toast carriers down via pulleys, starting a timer which turns on the heat and triggers an electromagnet. The magnet holds the carrier down until the timer stops. Then the magnet releases, sending the springs up and the toast popping.
What we've got going here, these pulleys will go in the four corners of the toaster, and there'll be a cable that runs vertical and then crosses so that both cables will run together, and that should keep it going straight up and down. Yeehaw!
Is that right? Is that right?
I think our toast should at least pop completely out of the toaster. Boing!
Bow!
And you're like, holy gosh. So anyway, we're at the point now where the cable's in, so it moves parallel. So now we can go ahead and start making the toast carriers. Why don't you hit the corners?
Gadget and I went over to the local home hardware store and picked up some springs right here.
There's gonna be a whole lot of vibration with the springs and thrashing around. I don't want them to snap off because that could be really dangerous. So I came up with this sort of super ultra mega bracket. Oh. There you have it.
Gadget and Thad test one garage door spring. with less than impressive results. But a second spring seems to do the trick.
Ready? Three, go.
Yeah, baby! That's what I'm talking about.
That'll launch some toast.
The springs are now set to pop the big toast up. So Gadget hunkers down on the next project, bending tubing for the bread carriers.
Bending, bending, bending.
Right now I'm bending this, this would be the bottom support for the bread. But I made this machine. It makes life a lot easier.
The bending tool that I brought in for bending all the little half-inch bars, that is a tool that I needed when I was making furniture. And I couldn't really find anything on the market that would do what I wanted it to do. So I spent the weekend and made that thing. I've done all kinds of metal fabricating, architectural metalwork, stairs, rails, structural steel, very large public artwork. I built the world's largest hand, the world's largest hammer, the world's largest pocket watch. And along the way, if I've needed to develop tools to make those things, I've done that too. So it's all been about sort of, you know, using other people's money to expand my horizons. It's been really fun.
This actually has a tube that we're gonna put underneath it to help support it, because this on its own won't support the bread. But this will spread the load out under that slice of bread.
With the big toaster that much closer to making toast.
Supposedly there's a toast chef showing up today.
Frank is reminded that the way to a man's heart is through his stomach.
Thank you, you, all right. Hey, I'm so glad you guys all make it here today for Toast Time with Frank. We have a special treat for all of you, especially you Toast fans out there. A friend of mine's in town. She wrote the book, I want to call it a Bible on Toast, because that's what it is. Woo-hoo! It's scorching hot and it's filling for you. Her name is Jessie Cool. Come out, Jessie Cool, my good friend Jessie.
Oh, thank you so much for making it.
All right. I read your book, and you take toast to a new level. Mm-hmm. You take to a level of artistry that I've never experienced or sensed before.
Don't get too serious here now.
Okay.
This is still all about toast.
I can fall in love real easy. I'm fragile.
My mom's chopped liver. Okay, so a little, come on. Good? Peanut butter and banana sandwich. Egg salad, caviar.
Okay.
Big bite. Oh, girl, you can do that.
You know, I gotta tell you, Jessie, this is such wonderful food. I can't keep it to myself. I'd love to share it with our studio audience.
And so, with toast in his belly and warmth in his heart, Frank ends the build's fourth day sharing the love with his team.
Jessie, thank you so much for being here.
My pleasure.
Okay, folks, good night now. Take care. Bye-bye.
See ya.
It's the last day of the build. With the team hoping to finish early, Kurt starts the day making the handles for the toaster's front.
Let's go plant some stuff. That's what I'm talking about. It's smooth as a baby's behind. Building the handle, the plunger handle. It plunges the toast into the toaster. Chop this in half. Spread glue all over it, clamp it up. Using yellow wood glue, the forever kind of glue. You should really leave it a couple hours. But I know everybody wants to leave early today, so I usually end up messing stuff up when I hurry, though. Never time to do it right, but there's always time to do it twice. After it dries, the glue joint will be stronger than the other pieces of the wood. All I know is that if you take that piece of wood and you break it, it won't break on the glue joint. It's gonna break somewhere else. Wood!
With the plunger handle done and the crew hurrying to finish early, Eric pitches in, designing the handle for the darkness meter.
Right about here.
Not enough.
Kurt's hypothesis about the glue joint strength.
That was not good.
Clearly doesn't hold up.
Rub them together and then pull them apart.
It ain't pretty, but after all that...
It is what it is now.
That's it.
This handle will have to do.
That's all she wrote.
Hi, how are ya? We're getting down the wire here.
The next step will be wiring this thing. The problem with this kind of thing is that a lot of the connections are left bare because we can't wrap them with tape, we can't put insulation on, it's too much heat. So we're gonna have to really be careful and take safety precautions so nobody gets fried while we're doing this.
If you plug this toaster into your house, the lights in your house will go out. This toaster draws as much as your whole house with air conditioning and everything. It's 100 amps, it's a normal house service. And that's what this guy draws all by itself. And if we short to the frame and someone's touching that toaster, they can get a real nasty surprise. So we have to be careful to make sure that everything's clear, doesn't touch anything. When you go big, there's always danger. When you make stuff this big, the slightest little mishap can result in permanent disfigurement or death.
I think the last day of build, I feel good. We've come together, everybody's had their own projects, and if they didn't, they helped each other. When you do get into a position where every one of your employees actually do work together with no headbutting at all, the obstacles are maybe sky high, you know, top of a mountain, but you can go right over the top of them. You fly over the top and right down the other side.
I think it's awesome. It'd be awesome to have my name in the book, you know? That's something that I can tear the page out and put it in a frame and put it on the wall.
What up? What up?
Operation Big Bread is officially underway. See, what happened was Gadget figured out that we need to cook the bread on a flat surface, and we need an oven big enough. So I called my friends over at Papa Quintel's.
Tony, you know, you guys made us that huge hot dog at that time, and well, I'm kind of in a bind. I need a huge slice of bread, and I need an oven that's got doors at least 4 feet wide.
Well, hopefully we got the thing to help you out. I've got an oven that's 5 feet wide and 16 feet deep.
Oh, that's great.
We know how to cook sausage, but we've never cooked bread, so you're on your own.
So that left me with an oven, but no dough. But thankfully, Jose from Breadworks set me up.
Okay, Frank, here is your dough, okay?
So the pressure's on. If the bread doesn't come out, I can't prove my toaster works, and I won't be able to go for another world record. So wish me luck.
Okay, where do I start?
Frank, first thing, you spray the pan, don't stick the bread.
That's right. Thanks a lot for helping me with this dough, Tony.
Whoa. Hey, Frank, what are you doing? Be gentle with treating the dough. You have to knead the dough.
Don't worry.
Be careful.
Perfect fit.
Cocina este pan por 2 horas.
Okay.
Bake the bread for 2 hours.
2 horas.
Frank, be patient.
Wow, it's a lot better than I expected. Okay, let's get it down. We should leave it down right here. We got bread. Finally, we have what looks like a slice of bread. But I have to give thanks to Jose. I think he'd be proud.
I am, Frank. I am.
So the final step in this process will be taking this internal mechanism and mating it to the housing.
Quick, I got some great news. I just got off the phone with Stuart Claxton at Guinness World Records, and he's gonna be here in a half hour to measure this. Yeah, so let's knock this out, okay? All right!
Yeah.
Stuart is coming from Guinness World Records. He should be here in about 10 minutes. He's pretty excited.
Let her fly!
Not many people get to be in the Guinness World
fly,
Records.
Fly, baby, fly!
Just to make an attempt at it. I feel privileged.
Go, all the way down.
But I'm gonna be in there.
No, when you're about an inch and a
half more. Right now, we're gonna test the toaster.
Probably.
Just a prelude to the real thing.
Let me have it, come on! Do it!
No, it's
already
on the
timer.
Give it to me!
You guys
are
holding
it.
Yeah! Now that's a wicked evil toaster. Yeah!
As the builders prep to peel the plastic coating off the stainless steel, Frank brings in a new friend.
Hey, guys! I got a good friend of mine here, Mr. Toast.
Hey, Mr. Toast.
Oh, stop.
Mr. Toast.
All right. Okay.
Mr. Toast.
We need some help peeling the siding off this thing.
Yeah, just remember that.
Mr. Toast is in a jam. Mr. Toast, are you in a jam?
Are you ready?
No, sir, we're not ready. We're not quite ready yet. We're very close, but we're not ready.
Never mind. It's time to make some.
Here we go.
Frank's big bread must air dry for a full day, so the team will test the popping mechanism without heat using foam pieces of bread.
Oh, put it down!
Watch your chin, man.
There it is.
Okay.
I missed that.
How long should it take?
30 seconds.
30 seconds. Woo! 30 seconds. Gonna go right now with your hand.
With the plunger pulled down, the 30-second timer is activated, and the team waits to see if all the parts will work together.
Come on.
The time has come. Stuart Claxton arrives at the shop to make his official measurements for Guinness World Records.
Oh, Stuart! How you doing, buddy?
All right, how are you, Frank?
Great, great.
Well, let's go.
Okay.
Can you give me a hand? That's 5 feet, 1 3/4 inches.
5 feet, 1 3/4 inches?
Yeah.
Check.
8 feet, 9 inches. That's 6 feet, 8 inches.
Check.
Looks pretty good so far, guys. I shall let you know. Speak to you soon, Frank.
You got it, Stuart. Take care, buddy.
See you guys.
Bye, Stuart.
See you.
Measurements taken. Stuart won't certify this a world record till the team proves it can toast.
This bread has to be at least 200 pounds.
When Big comes back, the team finds out if their toaster will set a Guinness World Record.
The only thing that's toast here is my nerves.
It's a pre-dawn arrival at the Encino Farmers Market, where the team will debut their toaster and hopefully set a world record.
That's a motley piece of bread.
We're at the Encino's Farmers Market. We only have 5 hours to prove that this toaster can toast bread. Otherwise, when Stuart Claxton comes here and we don't do it by noon, we don't get a Guinness World Record. So let's cut some bread.
Pretty moist.
Yeah, it's not really cooked on this side. It's kind of raw. Feel that? It's just like mush.
You should have brought the torch.
You know, we can wire this together so it stays and then flip it over and let it dry out a little more. Maybe the sun will come out and take some of the moisture out of this bread.
Oh. That ain't gonna happen, dude.
Now, this bread has to be at least 200 pounds.
Uh-oh. Drop it, just drop it.
Beautiful. That bread needs to lose some serious weight.
It's pretty doughy.
With the amount of moisture that's in this bread, we'll be lucky to toast it at all.
I feel bad. I mean, the bread was my responsibility. I mean, it's,
yeah, we know it wasn't personal.
Frank's part of our team. If Frank failed because he didn't make the bread,
Frank's bread failed. It ain't got nothing to do with the workability of the toaster.
No, it all has to go together. A team fails together.
As Eric reminds the team that there's no I in toast, Stuart Claxton from Guinness World Records arrives.
Stuart.
Hello.
How are you making it? Stuart.
Hello. All right. Well, I just wanted to let you know, I only have an hour. Are you guys set for that? Are you ready?
Yeah, we're ready.
I think we're ready to try the first one.
Oh, yeah, let's go. Yeah. Let's do it. Oh,
okay.
Up, Fred. Up, Simba. Up.
Put that baby in there. Yeah.
Lisa, the plunger.
But as it's lowered into place, the bread proves too heavy for the toaster springs.
It's all the way.
It's on. Plug it in.
Okay, we're all set to make some toast?
Well, right now, the toast is so heavy that, I don't know, the toaster won't be able to pop it out because it's already down just by the weight of the toast.
What's wrong, Lisa?
Well, I'm just disappointed because we talked about the springs getting different springs when we were billing them.
Yeah, and it just never got around to it.
If it toasts but doesn't pop, the thing is, that's what, at home, if that happened in your normal toaster, you'd say that your toaster was broken.
Well, right now, we're taking another approach. We're gonna take the other slice of bread that we have in reserve, we're gonna cut that down the middle in half, and hopefully that'll take care of a lot of the weight, and then we can put that one in.
Hey, it's manageable now.
Eric, what do you think the weight difference is between this piece and the last piece?
No, I think the weight difference, Lisa, that's good to ask. I think it's a lot.
It's gonna work. It's gonna work.
Time to.
Feel the difference?
Can't even feel it's there.
Really?
Go for it.
Go for it.
Let it go.
So if we have to keep putting it down, keep putting it down, but this will toast.
Yeah, and it will pop.
Good.
It came up. Go again, it's starting to toast.
It popped though, Stuart. Did you see it? Look, you see it, right?
As they attempt to toast the thinner piece of bread,
it's white smoke. It's the good smoke.
Smoke starts billowing from the generator, and this team's problems are mounting.
Stuart?
Hey,
it's not looking good right now. Just found out that they broke the breaker on the generator.
Well, we had it working on the other generator. I don't know why they got a different one.
The generator we have keeps popping its breaker switch. We got a bigger generator, but the switch is still the same size as the other one. So we're not even getting 20 seconds of toasting out of it. How about if we just keep trying to keep toasting? You know, we'll
we can keep trying, just keep doing it over and over. It'll eventually toast this bread.
Well,
20 seconds at a time.
Well, let's do it then. Well, that's the only alternative.
I mean, it's
the other problem.
Yes, sir. Got an idea.
What's that?
From the top, I can disconnect the top two or the top four panels on that side.
Mm-hmm.
That'll reduce the consumption by 25%. That might be enough so the breaker doesn't blow.
Let's do it.
Great.
While Gadget cools down the toaster by disconnecting some of the heating elements, Frank's frustration heats up.
Will you quit doing what I do? I'm sorry.
The only thing that's toast here is my nerves.
It's 12 o'clock, exactly. Noon. The doubt in my mind is that it's not popping properly, as you would expect a normal toaster would do. One side of it has also been disconnected, which I know is a power issue, but it should be sort of working full strength, obviously.
Okay, guys, let's come on down. Okay. It's decision time.
I'm concerned the look on his face.
On this occasion, right here today, right now, I'm unable to certify it as the world's largest toaster, as the new Guinness World Record.
Hey, it's fair enough, Stuart. I appreciate it.
All right, see you.
Thanks.
Bye.
All right, well,
I was very disappointed because we spent so much time.
There's a lot of negative things that started the day out.
Generator wouldn't push enough power. We couldn't run both sides, so.
Then when the first bread was too heavy, Stuart wanted it to pop up. It wasn't gonna pop up.
I thought it popped out high enough, and it was toasted in the middle.
It came up.
I thought it met his parameters, but you know, I kind of understand where he's coming from. It didn't work exactly like a regular toaster would at home.
I'm amazed that it did as well as it did, to tell you the truth, because I've never designed a toaster before, and this was a real challenge.
You know, welders don't cry. That's the only reason why I'm not.
So as the team looks ahead to their next big challenge, it's official. This world record attempt is toast.
It's not the toaster's fault.
Well, you made toast.